So to start with this experiment, what Hershey and Martha Chase did in 1952, which confirmed that DNA is the genetic material, first step of their experiment was to develop radio-labeled virus. Now we all know viruses are obligate parasites. That means they can only live as parasite. They have no other mode of survival. So they are parasites, or better say, they are endoparasites and they are obligate parasites. Plus, if they are not in their contact of the host cell, they will act like merely like a chemical, because in 11th class also you have learned that viruses are at the borderline of the living and non-living. So when they are not in contact with their host cell, or when they are not inside the host cell, they will act like a chemical, merely like a chemical, which can even be crystallized. Otherwise, if they are in contact with their host cell, they become active and then they pass their genetic material inside the host cell by making a hole. And then finally, their genetic material will take over the machinery. It's like a host, you can say slave and the master type of thing. So the host cell's genetic material and machinery will become a slave to the genetic machinery, genetic information of the virus, and virus starts making its own copies inside. So this topic is already covered in 11th class, when you learned about the topic of transduction in the classes I have explained. So the first step of their experiment was to develop radio-labeled virus. Now the main challenge with this point is you cannot perform experiment on virus, because viruses are, if they are not in touch with their host, then they will be just like a chemical or non-living. So how to change a virus? Because we can easily grow bacteria in lab, we can keep animals in lab, but you cannot grow virus in lab. So the first thing they did was they took the host cell. The host cell in this experiment is Escherichia coli, short named as E. coli. So the first step of their experiment was they grew E. coli in a medium that carried phosphorus 32, a radioisotope phosphorus 32. And the second step, remember, in this experiment we have two setups. One setup will have phosphorus 32, the other setup will have sulfur 35. These are radioisotopes of phosphorus or otherwise sulfur. So they grew E. coli in two medium. One medium had phosphorus 32, other medium has sulfur 35. And when you grow bacteria in artificial medium, obviously, when they do binary fission, or when they do asexual reproduction, or when they are making colonies, they are going to pick up material from their surrounding, just like transformation experiment. So when they pick up from the content from the medium, medium has a changed type of phosphorus or change type of sulfur. So when this E. coli grow and divides to form more individual, it will pick up a different type of phosphorus. And we all know phosphorus is a component of DNA and sulfur is a component of protein. So finally, what happen is, after a few generations are passed, all the E. coli in the new generation will have phosphorus 32 in their DNA, and all the E. coli in the second setup will have sulfur 35 in their proteins. I hope this point is clear to you. Now, these bacteria are radio-labeled. These are radio-labeled bacteria. Now, these bacteria were now infected with normal viruses. Bacteriophages means those virus which attack bacteria are called as bacteriophages. Now, once these radio-labeled bacteria are attacked by viruses, what will happen? Virus will develop their next generations inside them, and finally, because they carry the different type of phosphorus or different type of sulfur, so finally what will happen? The virus which will develop inside this bacteria will have phosphorus 32 in their DNA, and the virus which will develop in this bacteria will have sulfur 35 in their protein. This portion is missing in NCERT. Now, NCERT starts from here. What these scientists did is they took these viruses which have phosphorus 32 or sulfur 35. So two setups are there. One virus which carries phosphorus 32 was allowed to cause infection. So the first step you can say is infection. Second step is blending. Third step is centrifugation according to the NCRT. So they allowed the infection of these radio labeled DNA carrying phosphorus 32 type of radio isotope of the phosphorus or sulfur 35, S35. So when this infection is allowed, this infection means the virus will come and sit on the surface of bacteria and will start the process of infection. During the course of infection, genetic material is supposed to enter inside. Now, it was not clear to the scientist what goes inside. So they were confused whether it is the DNA entering inside or the protein entering inside. So the next step is what? The next step is blending. What is blending? Blending is the second step of their experiment, and blending is supposed to cause separation of the virus leftover body portion from bacteria. So when you do shaking in the blender, it is called as blending. Once the genetic material, because they don't know what is the genetic material. So once the blending is done, the leftover body portion will separate from bacteria. We all know viruses are nanoscopic and bacteria are microscopic. That means bacteria are heavier and viruses are lighter in their molecular weight, or you can say even they are heavier. Bacteria are heavy compared to the viruses. So definitely when you do blending, they will easily separate from each other. Once they separate, now the next step is what? Centrifugation. Now what is centrifugation? This concept is already done in the type of ribosomes, if you remember, S value. When you do centrifugation, heavy things will go to the bottom and light things will come to the surface.